What's up, y'all? Welcome to the NBA Weekly Post Game. This is where we share our views on the latest trending topics within the NBA. My name is Sha.
And I'm Evay, and we have a lot to talk about. In this episode, we're going to discuss our player of the week. We're going to talk about the impact of new coaches and how they're doing so far this season. And we're going to also discuss which coaches we think are on the hot seat. Let's get started.
My player of the week is D'Angelo Russell. Let me tell you, those Wolves stormed into Philadelphia on Joel Embiid's return and dropped the Philadelphia 76ers in a double overtime game. Let me tell you, D'Angelo Russell, when Vanderbilt and Carl Anthony Towns fouled out, he took his game to the next level and willed the Wolves to an awesome victory in Philadelphia. D'Angelo Russell is my player of the week.
Outward. Yeah, that's a good one. Okay, so mine is probably going to be obvious. My player of the week is Devin Booker of the Phoenix Suns. Can I just say that Devin Booker for the past week has been shot point extraordinaire. He put up 30-plus points in his last three games, 35 against Cleveland, 32 against the Knicks, and 30 against Brooklyn. Like, what? He's averaging right now 23-5-4. What? The Phoenix Suns are number two in the West because Devin Booker is putting up the type of production he's putting up. Now, granted, you got Chris Paul that's there and helping floor general the team. But if Devin Booker was not on that roster right now, and if he wasn't playing at his level that he's playing with right now, the Phoenix Suns would be nowhere near the number two spot in the West. Nowhere near. And another thing that really, when I'm speaking about Devin Booker, the latest NBA poll came out on who's going to be MVP, right? MVP list. I don't know why Chris Paul is ahead of Devin Booker on that list. Matter of fact, Devin Booker should be 1 through 5, but we're going to really be talking about it. And you could put Chris Paul in the 5 through 10 spot because Devin Booker is the most valuable. If I don't care how leading Chris Paul is going to do, if Devin Booker is not putting up them shots he's putting up, they're not going to be where they are. So for me, my player of the week and the most valuable player should be on the list and part of the discussion right now is Devin Booker.
Ooh, okay, go ahead, Book. I like that 1-2 step he did in New York. Put it down on the Knicks, turned around the following night, put it down on the Brooklyn Nets. Devin's balling right now. So the Portland Trailblazers brought over Chauncey Billups in a very controversial hire. How do you think he's working out for them so far?
Yeah, you know, for me, the Trailblazers are no different than they were last season. I have not seen, I'm just saying. Now, Terry Stotts needed to go. I get that.
Yeah.
I get that. He had been there for 8 seasons. It was time, right? Chauncey Billups has come over, and I haven't seen the impact that Chauncey Billups is supposed to bring to the Trailblazers right now. I will still give him time. I do believe now that Dame Lillard is finally getting on board. He's finally getting his stride. So maybe now we'll be able to see the impact that Chauncey Billups' leadership and coaching ability is going to bring to the Portland Trailblazers. But in order for me to see that, I'm going to have them not be at the same ranking they were last season. They were 6 last season, and they're at 6 right now. And we're talking about early in the season. And the way these other teams are playing, the Portland Trailblazers need to get on board. I'm going to need for Chauncey Billups, for me to see a major impact, that the Portland Trailblazers end up higher in the rankings in the West. But if they remain at number 6, that's fine. They got to make it out of the first round. They have to. We're talking about players that have been playing together for a long time. You got CJ and Dame.
And you know,
come on. Like, I don't know if Chauncey Billups came in at the wrong time. Came in at a time where Dame Lillard mouth says he wants to be there, but his previous actions on the court indicated he didn't want to. Now I can see he wants to be there because now he's playing more of his potential than he has in the past. So Chauncey, I gotta wait out on Chauncey Billups. I just don't know yet.
Funny you say that Dame is back. I think his shot is back. I think he's playing better, but I still think his mental is gone. I don't think Dame is 100%. And I don't know why I keep saying that. I just don't see it in him. He doesn't look excited to be in Portland. He looks like he's waiting for the free agency or the end of the season or whatever so he can make his splash in New York City. I don't I don't see Dame with the Portland Trailblazers next season. I do see Chauncey Billups kind of getting the Portland Trailblazers to the playoffs. I do see them exiting in the first round again. And unfortunately, you know, Chauncey walked into a sandstorm, you know, with the Portland Trailblazers. I don't think this is a good environment for him, his very first year as a brand new head coach. And a lot of fingers are going to be pointing at him. But right now, I'm pointing my finger at Dame Lillard, the head of the snake. He has to be all in. And I'm just not seeing it. He's getting the production now. He started really rough. And I think the only reason why his shot is back and the way he's playing well is he just got tired of the pundits talking about him. And then, you know, he's like, hey, I'm still Damian Lillard. I got to put up some points. But
yeah,
I still don't think he's there mentally.
Yeah, yeah, I can agree with that. What I can say is that I believe Chauncey Billups will be there next season. I see that. I think people understand, and also the organization understands that he's in this transition right now. They will have new players next season, and once they get rid of, if Damian Lillard decides to leave, it will be different. So the impact, we'll see. Chauncey Billups, just keep it pushing.
Now, the Boston Celtics right now, they have, oh my God, they have Jason Tatum just playing fantastic. But there is a huge disconnect between, I don't know if it's Jason, Jalen, Marcus Smart, and Coach Udoka. How do you think Coach Udoka is handling all this right now?
I don't think he's handling it well. I was on board when he first moved over because I believe discipline may have been lacking in that particular organization, on their roster and in their, you know, their play. But I think how he coaches these young guys is not effective for them. And also the comment that Marcus Smart made where he put Jalen and Jason Tatum under the bus, I think that further divided their roster. And there is something brewing in their locker room. Something is brewing. And it's going to eventually come out. And I think Marcus Smart, him being vocal about it in the public, kind of facilitated it even further. I think so.
Okay. I think Coach Udoka is definitely underachieving. Mm-hmm. And he's known for throwing his superstar players out into the media. Talking about how, you know, the last season it was your turn, my turn. Okay. You know, a lot of standing around on offense, not sharing the basketball. Pretty consistent with what Marcus Smart said to the media, right?
Yeah. Yeah, and if that is a fact, I'm fine with that. But I'm going to need the coach to figure out a way not to air it out where I, as a player, look bad.
Mm-hmm.
Like, no, you give the standard. We got some things to work on. Yeah, that's what we're going to be working on. You know the phrases that the coaches do so they can still, you know, have the player say face. And then you go in the locker room and you rip them a new one. But you don't do it in front of the public's eye. You don't do that. And I think him starting off that way, not maybe getting a chance to know the guys fully, it's impacting how they play. They don't want to play for that man. You can look at the body language and tell.
I know. And Jaylen Brown has kind of been in and out dealing with some nagging injuries this season. So maybe it's unfair to look at the Boston Celtics record at 10-10 right now and give a fair assessment. Still early in the season, but I agree with you. I think Udoka's discipline and his style of coaching is not resonating with these young guys. I thought it would, though. I'm a little disappointed because, you know, Udoka's fairly young. The players are young. Their nucleus is young. They've been together for several years. They were accustomed to Brad Stevens, right?
Yes.
Kind of laid back, kind of, you know, more interactive. I think Udoka is like a disciplinarian. I'm going to tell you what you need to do, you know, whereas Brad was probably more conversational. So Jason Kidd is currently leading the Dallas Mavericks right now. I believe they sit number 5 in the Western Conference. How's he holding up?
He ain't no different than Chauncey Billups because the Mavericks is exactly where they were last season. what are we doing? What are they bringing? Maybe it's too soon to tell. So I have to reserve my opinion about how Jason Kidd is doing because I just ain't seen nothing.
Yeah, you know, hey, the thing is, what I can say about Jason Kidd, it appears to me that now, finally, Luka and Porzingis are coexisting quite well in Dallas. I like what he's doing, bringing Tim Hardaway. It's just, you know, they're ho-hum. You know, the Dallas Mavericks are ho-hum, not really feeling them one way or another. Can't say that bringing Jason Kidd is any different than what Rick Carlisle did last season. I just can't say it.
I don't see it. I just really don't see it. I can agree with you on that. Porzingis appears to be a lot happier.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe that is the bright side of Jason Kidd coming over to the Dallas Mavericks, because of Porzingis being much more happier, being more productive, and because he's healthy as well, kind of adds to that success. So, yeah, you know, I just reserve my take on Jason Kidd, and we'll see how the season continues. If they're not making it out of the first round, then it's a bust for me anyway.
It's a bust, just like the Orlando Magic and Coach Mosley. You know, the Magic are 4-17 right now. I mean, golly, it's just a terrible situation. Orlando, like, they set up Coach Mosley. He's not going to win anything this season.
It's not. Are they in rebuild? What just, is the message for the Orlando Magic? Is this the rebuild message? Because a rebuild message gives coaches some room, right? If they're not in rebuild, then what is it? I can tell you right now, they need an experienced, more a vocal experience on their roster, and they don't have that. Yes, they have Robin Lopez, has been in the league for years, and yes, they have Gary Harris. However, Gary Harris was not as vocal as he should have been when he was with the Nuggets, and yes, they may have Terrence Ross. They're the most tenured players on their roster, but they are not the vocal players. And so we have all of these rookies, 1 and 2 year players that is supposed to compete with these veterans, the top players in the league that are, you know, 3 and 5 years in the league. How are they supposed to do that?
No, they're not.
They have not been right since Vooch, Gordon, and Fournier left. That's it. That is it. And until they get someone, and I don't know if it's enough to build your roster through the draft. You need to do through trades as well. You need to make your market more exciting for players that have tenure, that are not old, but yet still the name is enough to where people want to watch, right? They need that for the Orlando Magic, because how many more years will they be at the bottom? How many more?
I know. And sad to say, they were still at the bottom with Vooch, Fournier, and Aaron Gordon. So it's a dynamic in Orlando, and I don't know, and this team and the coach, I mean, poor guys. I think they're bottom of the Eastern Conference. 4 games. They've only won 4 out of 21 games. That is just unsatisfactory. I just don't have any words. And I hope Coach Mosley can stick around, you know, for the whole like rebuilding phase, and maybe they can start winning games, but it's not looking good right now.
You cannot put the pressure on teams when the roster isn't right. I think that's probably where I'm leaning to when we're talking about new coaches. You want these new coaches to come in and make miracles off of a roster that the general manager put together. Yup, you did that. So you want me to come in and now save this, and they're not, these players are not a right fit? Because you know, everybody that's in the league, they are good, but they may not fit together. So you put this fit together, now you want me to come in and work miracles. I can't do that.
Yeah, I know. You know, Coach Willie Green Jr. is down in New Orleans, and the Pels, they're not much better than the Orlando Magic. Their current record is 5-17, sitting at the bottom of the Western Conference. However, I'm going to give Coach Green some time. B.I., Zion has been in and out of the lineup. I mean, oh my goodness, Josh Hart, that's their nucleus right there. They haven't even played together this season. So I'm going to give Coach Green some grace.
Yes.
And until Zion gets back and gets back in shape, because that's going to take several games, I think the Pels are okay. Yes, they're at the bottom of the West. They may make it to the play-in tournament. Probably not, but I'm not willing to just turn my back on Coach Green quite yet.
No, I agree with you on that. I think Zion is his saving grace right now, because he has not been able to coach him in game time, because he hasn't been there. He's been recovering, and now he's going to have to get back into play in shape. So yeah. Willie Green gets a pass for me this season. No, I don't think his assignment should end like Coach Van Gundy's did with his one season with them. I think that he deserves a little bit more grace, because Zion Williamson has not played, and Zion Williamson is their franchise player. So if he's not on the court, how can you really measure the success of Willie Green Jr.'s coaching ability. You can't. You can't. So, yeah, the New Orleans Pelicans, y'all get a pass from me this season. But next season, if you got a healthy Zion Williamson on your roster and B.I. is healthy and you got all the other players and maybe some other pieces you may put in, then I can assess them truly. But right now, I can't do it.
But can we assess the Washington Wizards and what Coach Unseld Jr. is doing over there? Oh, man.
Quietly.
Yes.
Quietly. Can I just tell you that can he get the new Coach of the Year award? The Washington Wizards?
Yes.
Number
Happy
three?
To see. Happy
Number three?
To see. Yeah.
In the East? Stop.
I know. You know, I couldn't ask for anything else from first-year head coach Wes Unseld Jr. Not only, now just imagine this. You're playing in the shadows of your dad, who was fantastic for the Washington, then Bullets, passed away. You got all this pressure on you to do something. You're carrying his name. And look at him showing out for the Washington Wizards. I love
showing
to see it.
All the way out. And I love how he talks about their gaps in their play or what he's seen right now. The most recent was their turnovers. And so, you know, we're going to work on, you know, improving turnovers. That's different than this player didn't do this and they didn't do that and they need to do this. The team needs to work on turnovers and this is what we're going to work on. But again, I go back to, he has been able to coach this Washington Wizards team to number three in the East. Can we just pause there? Like, that is huge. But not only that, credit needs to be given to the general manager and president of basketball operations, whoever's responsible for putting together the roster. So you have a roster that is successful when you added Kyle Kuzma, you added Montrezl Harrell, KCP is here, you still got Bradley Beal, and that, you know, connection has been very successful. And then you put in a coach. You already gave him the foundation to be able to coach.
Mm-hmm.
Some of these organizations didn't do that. So now we're expecting these new coaches to come in and work with what? A broken foundation? So at least Unseld had the opportunity, it has the opportunity to help coach a group of guys that the roster construction, it fits.
I mean, yeah, this is a perfect situation for him. He has the talent. Can't say the same thing for Coach Mosley in Orlando or even Chauncey Billups in Portland.
And Willie Green as well. Because I'm sorry, please tell me when Zion Williamson has completed a full season.
Yeah.
I'll wait. So, yeah, it really does matter. Roster construction, talent, and how that connects matters, especially to a new coach. And so he's reaping the benefits of what it looks like when it's successful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know. Very happy for him. Now, Coach Rick Carlisle is on his second stint with the Indiana Pacers. I mean, he's been around the league for some time. The Pacers are doing okay. They're not considered one of the top teams in the Eastern Conference. What do you think about what Coach Carlisle's doing so far?
No different than how I feel about Kid. It's just no different. I mean, hey, you know what, Coach? But Coach Carlisle is not new to the coaching environment. He's been coaching for years, and now we're talking about he just left the Mavs. He was with the Indiana Pacers previously. Now he's back. You know what, Coach Carlisle will be fine. The Pacers will be fine, and they'll be right in the middle of the pack as they have always been. And that's just where he'll sit, and he'll be able to ride out his coaching tenure as long as he wants to. So
absolutely. I agree with you there. I like what Miles Turner is doing though. I like what he's doing. Mm-hmm. Yeah. As a quick little bonus though, which coach do you think is overachieving? I have Coach Borrego with the Charlotte Hornets totally overachieving. Did not see this from the Charlotte Hornets. Oh my goodness.
Did not see it again. When talent and roster meets the coach, it works. It takes both to connect. And until if that doesn't happen, you're going to have a disconnect and you're going to be looking like the Lakers. What I'm saying is you need to match. You just need to connect. So, yeah, no, he's an overachiever for sure.
Yeah, I like what he's doing down there. There's some coaches right now, I think, that are sitting on the hot seat.
Sitting on the hot seat.
Now, for me, first one out the gate is Coach Vogel in the Los Angeles Lakers.
It's time.
Yeah, I'm sick of him.
It's time. It's time for him. And unfortunately, the storied franchise that the Los Angeles Lakers are, there is no way that they can go out another season and not show up in some type of conference finals. It just can't happen. It can't happen. They Vogel, how much longer you gonna be here? You shit. I don't get it. Yeah. So Vogel's on a hot seat, and unless he pulls out some dominant alpha in him and coach and stop being coached. That's what I need. I want him to coach and stop being coached. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Wow. When he does that and make the moves that are necessary for the win and less necessary on how these superstars look, the Lakers will be much better off.
Okay, that's pretty deep. Who else do you have in the hot seat?
Silas.
Oh, Coach Silas.
So Coach Silas needs he needs a new environment. Maybe Coach Silas should come to the Lakers.
You said alpha dog. Coach Silas, unfortunately, is not an alpha. He wouldn't know what to do with LeBron and Russ and those guys.
You know what? You mentioned a snowstorm or a sandstorm. That's exactly what Coach Silas walked into. Oh, tornado.
Poor guy. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, no, he got bamboozled. I don't care what nobody say. Bamboozled. I'm going to tell you one thing and something else is going to happen and at its finest.
Yeah, because he took the job because he was looking forward to coaching Harden and Russell Westbrook. What did he end up getting? Oh, it's horrible. How come we aren't giving him grace, though? I mean, I have him on the hot seat, too. How come he doesn't get any grace?
This is his second season. Yeah. Okay, so then let me think about it. Maybe he should have grace. So then that means if he's not on the hot seat, who their general manager is? Who's the president of a basketball operations? Yeah. Somebody need to be on the hot seat. Somebody needs to be on a hot seat anytime we have John Wall not playing.
$40 million man.
I'm paying him.
Mm-mm.
Come on. So if it's not going to be Coach Silas, because I believe he walked into the dungeon. He walked into it. Not that he thought it was smoke and mirrors. He went past the door and was stuck. He got stuck.
Oh.
So if it's not Silas on the hot seat, then somebody from that Rockets organization needs to be on the hot seat, because the way that roster is constructed and how they're not utilizing their players is a problem. So mm-hmm. What is he supposed to coach? They did win their last two games. I will give them that. Maybe they have finally jump-started the car and they can finally move forward to winning more games. But
it's not likely.
I'm sorry. Well, I tried to find hope.
No, the last coach I have on the hot seat, and you are not going to like this, is Nick Nurse. He's not getting the most from the Toronto Raptors. They should be in the top six in the Eastern Conference. Ooh. They might need a new voice.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Nick Nurse didn't see that one coming, but let me think about Nick Nurse for a minute, which is leading me to believe that the real coach was Kyle Lowry.
Oh, man. Must have been.
Wow. Wow. I'm speechless.
The Raptors are talented. Why are they sitting at the bottom of the East? Well, you know, it's just.
I was okay with them last season because they were displaced. They had a lot of rookie and, you know, other people on their roster. But that roster this time.
Yeah, Scotty Barnes.
Let me count the ways. Scotty Barnes, rookie that's doing his thing, Siakam, Van Fleet, Gary Trent Jr.
Yeah.
Now, I know.
Uh-oh.
Just a thought. Should Popovich be on the hot seat?
No. First of all, Popovich is immune to any hot seat.
Okay.
He's just not. You can't put Pop on the hot seat, though it is time for him to exit the arena. He ain't on the hot seat because nobody, he's like the president of basketball operations and a coach. He gonna fire himself?
No. No, I don't think he should leave the organization. He should still be there. President of basketball operations, I am fine with that. What I am saying is on the sideline, should we consider When can we start the discussion on Popovich's coaching retirement? I'm waiting for Popovich to be Pat Riley. I want him in a Pat Riley type role. That's what I see him as. But I know the Spurs fans get mad because they love Pop. Yeah. I love him too, if that's what you love. What I'm saying is I'm not asking him to leave. I'm asking him to transition. That's it. Stay basketball operations, do all that. But on that sideline,
It's time for him to step aside.
When will those discussions be a fair discussion? That's just all I'm saying.
I mean, you got DeJounte Murray wasting his young talent down there in San Antonio. You like to call the Spurs the dungeon. That is hilarious. But DeJounte Murray, you got Keldon Johnson. Like, they have a young nucleus, but they're playing such a boring type of offense. You can't get up. You just can't get up for that. If I'm a young player, I got to play this boring offense. No, I want to run and gun. I want to be up and down the court. I want to play exciting basketball, but Popovich holds them back. And I think that's what we're seeing.
So again, I want to be clear, Spurs fans. I am not saying that Popovich needs to leave the building. What I am saying is that he just needs to step aside from the sideline. That's it. Give another coach an opportunity. That's all I'm saying.
Okay.
With this new play of basketball.
I'm with you on that. Luke Walton.
What about him?
His seat was so hot that they went on and fired him.
They had to get rid of him. 18 games in, it was like, you know what? We try.
Yeah.
Good for him. Then had Alvin Gentry come in, and the Kings have now won two of the three games they've played since Luke Walton's departure.
I'm telling you, and you know why. Coach Alvin Gentry has figured out a way to incorporate Marvin Bagley III into the offense. 6'11". Oh, my God. Lefty, too. Unorthodox. Coach Gentry, my hat's off. Because the Kings are winning games now.
I wonder if Coach Gentry was like, put him in. Luke, why are you not playing? I mean, you know, on the sideline, like, why you don't play Bagley? You know, if you put Bagley in, he can do X, Y, and Z. And Luke Walton was probably like, nah. I don't know. I was just thinking, like, was he saying it while he was, you know, assistant coaching?
He was like,
I got my chance. Now, guess what? Let me show you how you play the young bull. Let me show you how you play him.
Mm-hmm. Good for him. I'm just happy to see it. I like the fact that De'Aaron Fox now has a coach that can actually coach him. You know, because Fox is a stud. I mean, I just really like him.
I just can't stand these young players that have the juice and not get the recognition that they need. It just burns me. I hate that. So good for De'Aaron Fox. Yes.
Yeah.
All right, y'all. That's all we got. And until next time, goodbye.
Peace, y'all.